This exhibit features the work of Mark Willey from Los Angeles, California, Pat Pope from Missoula, Montana, Joanne Sosia from Cambridge, Massachusetts, Mo Armstrong from Cambridge, Massachusetts, Danny Gator from Floodwood, Minnesota, and Vita Wilson from Brattleboro, Vermont. Also featured in the show is Gregory Gordon from New York City. The Anchor House of Artists is a studio and a gallery which represents artists who have mental health consumer, survivor, ex-patient affiliations. The Anchor House's mission is to restore artists to their creative careers. This is our first show of artists from out of the region. We welcome you to our first exchange show. Welcome to Massachusetts and the Cultural Exchange Show. We've got a few visitors, and three of us are going to take you through the show. So let's go. This is a work by Gregory Gordon. Greg thinks of this work as, in terms of performance. He calls this work performance art. And the Blacklight Revolution, which this is, is a culmination of this performance work. What do you think?
I like it. Mm-hmm. It's different. It's, like I said, it's very science-like. You know, there's a lot of science involved with it.
Yeah. The comments have been, people are saying it's hypnotizing and calming.
Mm-hmm.
We had one person actually stuck their hand in it, and now we'll...
Yeah, it also looks good if it was in a nightclub, you know, right. How like a discotheque or something.
That's interesting, because
that's nice.
That's where he's done a lot of his performance work, is
yeah.
In discotheques.
It's nice.
His work is heavily hinged on spiritual beliefs and has adopted a life philosophy that comes from the New Testament. He quotes, "Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven," which is Matthew, from Matthew 5, verse 16.
Mm-hmm.
And he's selling these, he's offering these as a signed edition of 777. He's got a website at lightoftheworld@prodigy.net. Jenny, would you unplug that? Jenny,
I gotta unplug this.
Okay.
Dan, you can watch to see what happens there.
Yep. Shoot. It's nothing but a balloon.
Yeah, nothing but a balloon. The other thing that you can do is this. Watch this.
He's constructed it out of an air conditioner motor, party lights and sockets, and this plastic box, which he's had pre-cut for him.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
This painting is by Vita Wilson. It's called The Girl Inside. It's oil on a rag paper.
Vita is the president of the Vermont Psychiatric Survivors Incorporated. It's a peer organization that disseminates information and replaces isolation with support for mental health consumers in Vermont. She's found strength in helping others as a trauma survivor herself. She works expressionistically in oil, and she works in other media too for about 10 years. And 4 years ago, she started formal study at the River Gallery in Brattleboro. And this is her first professional show outside of school.
Hmm. So is this a face or of some kind, or a skull of some kind, or?
Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, you get this sense of a presence there, don't you?
Mm-hmm.
She titles it "The Girl Inside." Through all that darkness, you have that red, warm glow, which seems encapsulated in the umber gray colors that are surrounding it.
Hmm.
Okay. Over here, she's got one that she calls her view of heaven.
Looks like a vortex.
Yeah.
So is that like repeatedly painted over on purpose? Because it seems like the texture is very thick.
It does have several layers to it, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Like an underpainting of blue, and it's like the white below it.
Mm-hmm.
It's interesting. I hadn't thought of the time element involved in creating that, but
mm-hmm.
She did start with that sort of field of blue, and then on top of it is that white spatter. It's so wonderfully intentionally done.
Hmm.
This is
same artist, or?
Same artist,
right?
This is Vita Wilson. This is her, she's got two here. One's called The Spout, and the other one is called The Orange Girl. This one that you're looking at now is The Spout. When I saw this, I thought of the story of Job for some reason. I don't know if it has anything to do with, not Job, Jonah.
Jonah and the whale, yeah.
The intersection between paint and beauty is a bittersweet moment, and I try to capture it in paint, is her quote.
Down below there?
Yeah.
Yep. Trying to get a close-up of that. There you go.
How's the autofocus working on it?
It's fine. Yeah. It's working fine. There we go. Yeah, it looks... I like that one. It's like a cataclysm almost.
Yeah.
And this one over here is, what's the title for that one?
The Orange Girl.
The Orange Girl. Hmm. Yeah, that one definitely is very texturous. Almost,
yeah.
You know. There's a lot of layers and layers of paint on that.
Yeah, it's a world in motion. She has a great sense of control for such a very action-oriented painting technique.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's very fiery.
Oh, it's beautiful.
Definitely. All right.
All right.
So we're going to do Dann.
Yeah. Floodwood, Minnesota. Dann Gator. Danny's actually, he's been a painter some 20 years, a little more than that, and he's really put his work out. He's gotten his work out across the country. He heard about the Anchor House from a source in New Jersey. I have no idea how they heard about us in New Jersey.
Hmm. News gets around.
Yeah, I guess so. His paintings, when he told me, when he's sending them out here, he said, well, you know, Mike, my paintings are 15 pounds. And I said, oh, no, I couldn't be there. What, they're acrylic and canvas? And he said, oh, yeah, they are. And sure enough, when they got out here, some of these canvases are very, very heavy. See, they're
yeah, it's almost like you squeezed all the paint out of a tube and just placed it there.
It's very thick, and I don't know if he uses a medium in with his paint to give it texture, yeah. Like a modeling paste.
Well, no, there's a certain kind of paint nowadays that is very clumpy and texturous, and it's used often, and this looks like he's using that material or that medium, those kind of paints.
I really don't know how he achieves it, but
really?
They're very, very, very thick.
And then this one, I like this one a lot, the colors in that.
Yeah, this one's called the Red Man. He talks about his paintings being transceivers.
What do you mean transceivers?
Well, they're explanation for his work, and I think he talks about them as like transceivers from a spiritual world into this world. He talks about his processes, his loaded knives and brushes with acrylics to apply thick layers of paints to surfaces to see if I could paint what I was sensing and to give form to my voices.
It's very colorful. I like the Red Man.
Yeah.
Is this a wagon wheel or something, or?
It is a wheel, yeah.
A wheel, yeah.
It's, whatever's happening here, it looks like it's all in motion.
I can see a sun right there, like it's a field.
Uh-huh.
I mean, it just looks like something in motion in the grass. I mean, that's how I see it.
Yeah.
Constantly moving.
It almost just looks as if the painter ran by and the painting somehow jumped out of him on the canvas.
Mm-hmm.
It's really amazing. This one in particular, you can see up top here just how very, very thick this is. It's as thick as my finger, some of the paint. It's, in a sense, it's top-heavy in that sense. This clump of paint, you know, it's the size of my finger again.
Mm-hmm.
Which makes them sculptural in a sense.
Or a relief, you could say.
Yeah, relief, yeah.
And are these two characters? Or
let's see. I'm going to put my list here somewhere. Red Man and Friends.
It's called Friends?
Friends, yep.
Huh.
I don't know if they look very friendly. Looks like a gathering of people.
Yeah. Well, it looks like it's almost like a father and son.
Yeah.
Because you have the little red guy down there, and then the large.
Yeah. And then there's that blue guy in the corner, though.
Yeah.
Blue guy to the orange guy, the little yellow guy. See that little yellow guy there, next to the red guy?
Yeah.
It's like the more you look at it, the more little guys you see.
It almost looks like the pink one has at least two faces.
Yeah.
Don't you see that?
The purple eyes and the white eyes?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's almost like, sort of like futurism. There's a technique they use where everything's moving and constantly moving.
Mm-hmm.
So it's almost like he's moving his head back and forth and it's creating an image of.
Oh, I gotcha, yeah.
Double images.
Huh.
Yeah. Okay, and this one looks very basic.
Yeah, this is Monster Me, he calls it.
Nice title. I like
Monster
that.
Monster Me, yeah. How come you like it?
It sounds unique. I mean, it's a fun title as well, you know.
You got your paintings about monsters.
Yeah, looks very cartoon-like.
Yeah.
Or
childlike.
Childlike, yeah. As well. And I mean, the title, Monster in Me, is almost like referring to something childlike as well. Like a, almost like an imaginary friend or some kind, or does he describe what the title, does he go into the title about Monster in Me? Does he say anything, expound anything about that? Or?
Well, it's Monster Me.
Monster Me.
Yeah, and this is, you know, it's in some ways, it's like the monster and me, or me the monster, or
You know, it's like all these meetings. There's this quote down there. My paintings are roadmaps of my bewilderment and transceivers of understanding for my spiritual visions. Think of them as single-frame movies where the mind rolls, but the picture stays the same. It's an unfortunate reality that we need to protect them behind glass, but here we have these works that are made of very intricate little beads. I don't know how close you can get up on them. And Pat says, I see each bead as a prayer. My work is made of hundreds, sometimes thousands of prayers. So it sounds like a very meditative process for him, process of doing and undoing.
Two-headed snakes.
Yeah.
Very Indian-like.
Well, he learned the technique from Western Indians, Western Native Americans, and he's taken that technique and used it as his medium and to develop his own personal messages, as with the dragon and now the little heads with the lizards on them. I gotta see if I can pull one of these out.
Right.
There we go.
Okay. Extreme close up. It's kind of blurry, but.
Blurry?
Okay, let me just again. There you go, I got. It's nice.
Hey, how are you doing?
Hey. Huh.
You see this little lizard on the back?
Yeah.
It becomes.
It looks like a Gila monster.
Yeah. Gila monster on a rock.
Yep.
But it's a face.
Where did this person grow up, Pat? Where did Pat Pope grow up?
Well, he's out in Montana.
Montana.
And I don't know if he grew up there. He heard about the Anchor House through a connection in Springfield. And he was helping a friend move back to the Springfield area and took the opportunity to come by. That is.
It is. Must have took a long time just doing that. It's very intricate. So that's the whole thing is beads, or
all beads?
All
yeah.
Beads, really? Wow.
Yeah.
Hmm.
I'd say it weighs. I'm pretty bad at weights, but
yeah.
I'd say it's 2 pounds, maybe.
Yeah. I like the pattern on its wings.
Yes. We got a review in the Greenfield Recorder, and the writer was very taken with this piece because she saw it as marionette-like. And it has this little hanger on it. And, it does have a marionette quality to it. Yeah, Joanne Sasha. Now, we met Joanne. We had a show in Lowell, Massachusetts. And she just happened to be at that conference. She was selling her images. It was a conference that we were showing artwork from the Anchor House at, and she was showing her images in cards, and I loved her work and wanted to have an opportunity to show it. That was almost 2 years ago, so when we were pulling together this show, I got back in touch with her, and she was able to release some of her works, and what we have here is there's a self-portrait, or a portrait.
The first one is a self-portrait?
It's portrait? A portrait. This
okay.
Is
let's see. Three faces?
Woman in transition.
Oh, yeah.
Colored pencil and marker.
Mm-hmm.
Then the next four images are a series. They're called My MI series, MI for mental illness. And they tell the story of, well, there's a lot of universality to it. Just the path of getting involved in a system that is so confusing, and a process of living which feels tormented. And
so there's a series of how many? Four, you said?
Yeah, there's the first four images in the blondish, the mm-hmm. maple frames.
Yep.
They're this series called My MI series, which reads My MI series. And we've been offering those as laser reproductions as a set available for $25, or the originals as a set for $400. This one here, for instance, the writing here says, they are attacking again, 1977 to 1979. John, I'm about to die. Goodbye. There's a deathbed. Fearful, lonesome, suicidal, sick me, hippie garb, only clothes, vomit pills, everything lost, barren apartment. I throw up pills. Bulimia helps for once. I'll take these pills to kill myself right now. Meds, gas on. So, guns at the window, there's danger at the window, there's mental illness, written in the patterning, illusions, hallucinations, the sense of the character being threatened. And
so
all the walls,
the windows, are those people who are threatening, as you said?
Yeah, threats at the windows.
Yep.
Threats within, without.
Yeah.
The floor is closing in, the walls are closing in.
Just trying to get each series, each little dialogue piece here.
It's hard to translate them into videotape here. They are very complex.
I'll break everything. Windows, mirrors, furniture. You'll always be crazier. It's repetitive. Give me money.
Yeah,
drugs. Jimmy.
This man who...
warrant for arrest.
Who attacks her, abuses her. She's feeling so vulnerable. And she's really... These, in fact, while they are... They recount a desperate time and a desperate history. They are, in fact, celebrations because she's at this point in her life where she's overcome much of this, and she's able to review with clarity where she's been. So she's, in a way, it's a celebration of her making it through.
Survival.
Right, yeah. Survival and, you could say, surpassing as well.
Uh-huh.
Her quote is, "My personal philosophy is to be well from mental illness and to pick up the life which it destroyed." She started out as a painter at Rutgers University. She was in the fine arts program there. And she has a few paintings left from that time, but much of her work has been destroyed.
Wow.
In that time.
Hmm. What are these paintings in the blue frames, are they a series as well?
Yes, or? They are. And this one is called Up to the Three. This one, the one, 1, 2, 3.
1, 2, 3.
They're called My Life in Hell.
Hmm.
And again, they tell
bulimia.
The story. Hmm. Yes, the cat in a box. This middle one here, Joanne, you should know how many women have commented on this. How they feel so very, so much an affinity with you in this statement. So alone is this.
So alone is the woman sitting in the chair?
Or? Yeah, she's got her little birds up there. And I don't know if the camera can see that. But then you go to this last one here. And there's her.
Okay, the birds.
Yeah, Mr. You, and Mrs. Bloom.
You missed the monster.
Oh, the monster?
Yeah, what is that?
No, this is part of this series.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
so that's the last part. Really? Because I want...
She says, eats me up raw.
Hmm.
It's just so... Articulate, it's very articulate.
This also reminds me of a lot of like newspaper cartoons, how they have like, you know, like they have a bull or whatever, and they have an eagle and it has USA written underneath it,
uh-huh.
You know, and then you have the bear and it's Russia. This is very similar to that, like she could be doing that.
Like political cartoons.
Political cartoons, yeah, it's very similar because like,
The
characters are just named after different, you know, different feelings, different emotions or illnesses or whatever.
Yeah.
And this one with the parakeet?
Yeah, Mr. and Mrs. Bloom. I guess those are her parakeets.
Ends on a light note.
Yeah.
I like that. I used to have a few budgies before.
Yeah, who hasn't had budgies?
Yeah. Powerful, very powerful
yeah,
work.
Mark Willie from Long Beach, California.
Okay.
I used to live out in Van Nuys when I was a little boy. I had to do a relief map of California. And I remember Long Beach is this long area of the coast. Anyways, Mark is... I think he's from West Springfield originally, or he's from Western Massachusetts originally, and traveled out to California when he was a 18-year-old kid. He met a painter out there, and was really turned on to painting. And he came back to Massachusetts for a while, and he spent some time in Northampton State Hospital, and discharged really began his painting career. And what when he got out, he went back to California and he picked up some imagery, the Mexican Day of the Dead celebration, which is a Mexican Catholic indigenous peoples kind of a amalgam celebration as for All Souls Day. And he took that imagery and ran with that for a while. And he had some success out in the California art market, and has developed what were initially these Mexican influences into other world influences. And so he's got some Tibetan stuff going on.
Mm-hmm.
He's got some Americana stuff, some psychedelia.
Yeah.
He uses this method of painting, which I think he calls it Tonkin painting. It's a Tibetan form of painting. And basically what's involved is with a dusted charcoal paper, he'll make a drawing on one side of the canvas. Then he's able to flip that over and repeat the drawing on the other side. And that way get the imagery to be so exacting. And
It's a different technique. I never heard of that before.
Yeah, it's...
But whatever works, you know.
Oh, yeah. It's very carefully executed. It takes them upwards to a month or more to create some of these canvases.
Yeah, this one right here, I like this. It's very detailed.
Oh, Jesus.
It has a lot. It's very powerful.
People have responded very well to these, too.
Yeah. I can see a whole Halloween theme in this one with the witches.
Yeah.
And
well, there we go. I mean,
spiders.
Halloween is around the same, you know, All Hallows Eve.
The Day of the Dead.
Celtic or European, also around All Souls Day.
Yeah, and also you said about the Day of the Dead that actually Halloween, I guess, is before the Day of the Dead holidays. And I guess the Day of the Dead happens around November.
Yeah, it does.
Right after
November,
Halloween.
November 1st.
Yeah.
All Saints Day.
Yeah.
It's, you know, it's pan-cultural or trans-cultural in the sense that it's all about life and death and this, the passage of the self through different forms. This one in particular, you have that trilobite up at the top there, that ancient bug mollusk kind of creature, which is long extinct, but one of the first forms of life on Earth. And
did he paint that, or is
yes,
it
yes.
really?
And then he has those kind of proton, almost pre-organic forms in the corners. You can't tell on the videotape, but the little sections in the corners are beaded in the sense that he's got these little beads of paint. They're slightly raised, so they have this sense of almost being like beads. And the surfaces themselves have the quality of eggshell. They're just really, he really handles the paint with a great deal of care. Not unlike you, Dann. Very careful painter as well. It's hard to be a
from it me. Is very hard.
Yeah, I mean, it's meticulous and labor.
Meticulous,
intensive.
Yeah, that's a good word.
Yeah.
Especially I was reading about, he was influenced by Dali, and definitely Dali is very meticulous in his work. He's very precise in where he wants things, where he arranges things on his canvas.
Yeah.
And he's very, I guess Dali claimed that his paintings are almost like photorealistic dreamscapes. I think he said something like that. And because he makes it so, you know, exact and so precise and meticulous. By understanding this guy, he was, Mark was inspired by Dali as well, I was reading.
Yeah, Dali, Disney, psychedelia, Tibetan art, and pop culture. He's a fairly studied artist. He's taken a look at.
And this is the famous one that's on the cards.
Yeah. He's shown with some pretty famous cartoon artists as well in
really?
California. Noah Armstrong has given his life over much to advocacy, and he is the director of an organization here, the Peer Educators Project in Cambridge, which has a mission to train mental health consumers in skills necessary to conscious raise and with the public and to end social stigma. And he is, he's also been out in the, he's a Vietnam veteran from 66 and 67, I think. And spent some time out in Haight-Ashbury. And so he picked up on the beat poets very early and sort of developed this way of working himself. He's, you know, spent many, many years both with the experience of homelessness and the experience of retreat. And he spent some time in Wyoming in a kind of a retreat to himself, and has gone inside, and he's come out with this great sense of humanity. And he calls his work affordable art in the sense that he doesn't want any sort of pretensions attached to it. And he illustrates his poems.
an angel.
Yeah. Let me see.
What does that say up there?
The old angel came back to Earth. He wanted to see how people were treating each other. He was sad by the events. There was such a way of not knowing who started the fight. People were fighting. Everyone pushing each other around. These are times which are sad for angels.
Hmm.
And this one here is, John Hardy was a desperate man. He stood in his jail cell and cried. He was the person who shot a man on the West Virginia line. He couldn't get away. He was John Hardy, left to look at his life, left to feel some sense of shame.
Hmm.